Good evening, everyone. I'm not sure how to start this. I think I prepared that I introduce Professor Bello. Professor Bello Chancellor is the Vice Chancellor of the British University, and may I invite him to open this event, please.
Thank you, Actually, it's a pleasure to have you all here today. I think I'm honestly the only person here who can dream about it. Oh, we can't know about this.
Could be something. Okay. But, we have two here.
Oh, okay. All right. Nice start. It's a pleasure to have you all here at the British University in Dubai. The British University in Dubai was established about 12, 13 years ago. And we took our world to law, or the concession law dispute resolution, about 6 years ago.
Yes, 2010.
And our program in the day of concession law dispute resolution. So the way that BUID works is only in postgraduate programs, master and doctorate programs. And we do have a strong academic relationship with the institutes. There, University of Manchester, Cardiff, Edinburgh, Glasgow, London, and also about getting Belfast, which works with your thing here, British-Irish. And to see that British and Irish are working together in one association, that's a very interesting one. So it's nice to have you all here. I'm a member of the CIR, by the way. I may find some of the discussion here meaningful at the end of the day. I wish you luck and success for this.
Thank you, Professor Abdullah, for these remarks. And again, I'd like to welcome everyone here. I thank the British Irish Provincial Bar Association, which is usually referred to as BIBA, for deciding to hold this event in association with the British University in Dubai. It's a pleasure to meet all of you here and to welcome you in Dubai. I attended the previous event of BIBA. In the DIFC, which was very interesting, and I hope that you find this and I can advise some people attend as well. And I hope that you find this event as well interesting. May I start by welcoming Mr. Dave Kisman, and I will leave him to introduce himself more as well and speak on certain matters regarding the commercial arbitration and litigation. David Kisman is a King Council. He's the chairman of BIBA, and he is a deputy High Court judge of the Chancery Division and the Queen's Bench Division in England and Wales. He is an associate member of the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators, appointed a Queen's Counsel in 2008 at practicing commercial law. From City Court, London, and King's Chambers, Manchester. Areas of expertise of practice include arbitration, securities and banking, commercial fraud, insurance, financial services, company partnership disputes, trust, and sports law. Thank you, David, for coming to the bar.
Well, thank you very much for those very warm words of welcome. Can I express a particular thank you to Professor Abdullah and also to Professor Masada for arranging this event. We're absolutely delighted to be here with the British University. The British-Irish Commercial Bar Association, as you know, is a joint endeavour between the United Kingdom and Ireland. And the professions within the four jurisdictions that make up the United Kingdom and Ireland. It is, as you've so rightly said, Professor Abdullah, it is an amazing thing to see it, because in the not so distant past, it might not have been possible to embark on this joint venture, but not only do we have events between the four jurisdictions, we have increasingly looked outside of the jurisdictions and we work together. It is correct to say that the British-Irish Commercial Bar Association is a 50-50 partnership between the United Kingdom and Ireland. It has two chairmen. My opposite number is the Irish chairman, Marcus Daly, senior counsel, and I am the United Kingdom chairman. And underneath that level, there are four vice chairmen, one for each of the jurisdictions. That is England and Wales being one, Scotland, Northern Ireland, and Ireland. So we're delighted to be here. This is the second event that we've had this year. And BICBA is now a permanent fixture. It is an organization that has the blessing of both the British and the Irish governments. It has enjoyed the support of the respective ambassadors within the UK and Ireland, as well as the respective foreign offices. So it's good to be here with our colleagues in the United Arab Emirates, and in particular here in Dubai. We see this as an opportunity to learn from each other. And the way this room has been arranged is in the form of a round table. Please avail yourself of that, because it gives you an opportunity to speak and to ask questions. And we will be delighted if you avail yourself of that. Can I ask on a particular welcome myself to three of our colleagues who are here? Can I say a particular welcome to Victor Budzinski, who is a most distinguished mediator in this region. Delighted to see you here, Victor.
Thank you.
Can I also welcome in particular David Barnival, senior counsel, who is the chairman of the Bar of Ireland, and who will be speaking later on. And finally, last but by no means least, of course, Michael Stevens, who is the immediate past president of the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators. There is no one who, as far as I'm aware, knows more about arbitration than Michael. Michael has, during his tour of duty, went around the world, and I think made it his mission to say hello to every single member of the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators. And if he didn't, if he missed anyone out, I think it wasn't for the want of trying. So it is great to have you here. Now, I'm going to move on with the agenda that we have. And so you're probably wondering why I'm speaking into this microphone in such a relatively small room. This is being recorded, so the reason for speaking into the microphone is for the benefit of the recording and not for you. So if you have, if you can't hear clearly enough, please put up your hand and ask for something to be repeated, and then we'll get the message. So subject to that, I'm going to simply say a brief word of introduction about my co-chairman for this event, namely Professor Ayman Masada. Professor Masada has a long experience in the area of construction law, and he advises in UAE and regional construction law cases, as well as on FIDIC standard contracts. It's good to see a number of Ayman's students here, and I've had a chance to speak to quite a few of them. He's published extensively in this area in international journals and also spoken on international conferences and events. And he will be speaking later on his specialist topic of construction law. I was pleased to see, as I looked down his biography, that he actually studied not only at Jordan University, but also at Aberdeen University, where the climate is very different. Nowhere near as warm as here. And likewise, although the climate may be slightly better, did his PhD in Bristol. So, Ayman, thank you very much for the warm welcome that you've extended and for all the work that you and your staff have put into this event. Thank you. Now, we're going to move on, if we may, to the first item. the first talk is one that I was asked to do, which is to talk about strategies in arbitration and litigation. In my quarter of a century of litigation and arbitration, it has occurred to me that there is very little talk about the actual strategies. It seems to be the accident. It seems to be something that you learn from other people by experience and by guesswork. There isn't really the opportunity to discuss it as a separate topic. And I thought, what better than to begin with a Chinese general, 1,500 years ago, by the name of Sun Tzu. And Sun Tzu was a great military leader, philosopher, and strategist. And his work, The Art of War, is regarded as compulsory reading at Harvard Business School and in a number of other walks of life where strategy, whether it be sport, business, politics, as well as military studies, are being considered. He said this: appear weak when you are strong, and strong when you are weak. He also said that every battle is won before it is fought. And never surround your enemy. And in this I do paraphrase, for those of you who are familiar with Sun Tzu, and I certainly do paraphrase this. Never surround your enemy, always lead them a way out, otherwise you force him to fight. Now, whether you are thinking about your overall strategy or you're fine-tuning your cross-examination of a particular witness, you want to bear that in mind. Never surround your enemy. Because sometimes the escape route is the best route as far as the other side are concerned. Always provide them with a way out. And I'm going to divide up my talk in the following way. First of all, analysis. Secondly, strategy. Thirdly, tactics, noting the difference between strategy and tactics. Four, managing expectations. And five, costs. Analysis, strategy, tactics, managing expectations, and costs. So, to begin with the first of it,
it's just one screen, so we'll get back to just wait.
All right, that's fine. All right. The first part of my talk is about analysis, and I think I missed something out because there are two other important things. Analysis, analysis, analysis. The whole point of that is that it is absolutely fundamental. It is not enough to pick out the main point of a case. It is not enough to have a rough idea of some similar case that you may have come across. It is essential to analyze the case for its strengths and its weaknesses. Both the legal and the factual merits of both cases must be analyzed at the earliest stage. And I say both cases because for every case that comes to you, there are in fact two cases in there. There is the case that your client wants to advance, and there is the case that the other side want to advance, and you have to analyze both. And that goes for the initial stage of considering matters, and it will also apply when it comes to preparing for the trial or the final hearing. You have to prepare both sides. And if you don't, then what you have done is you have blinkered yourself, because you have assumed that you have got a wonderful and unassailable case, and how could anybody possibly disagree with you? That is another world. It's an ethereal world and doesn't belong to the real world. So you prepare both. And when you talk to your client in consultation about the analysis that you provided, you press the client in respect of both the strengths and the weaknesses, having analyzed recognised both sides of the case. And there is, when it comes to the final bit, when the client always asks, well, what are my chances in this? You have to be realistic and spell out the chances of winning and the chances of losing. Don't just say 60% chance of success and leave it at that. It's amazing how many times the client will look absolutely amazed when you say there's a 60% chance of winning and a 40% chance of losing. If you only say 60% chance of winning and don't say anything about losing, then the client thinks it's got a winning case. Well, put it another way, you can take another step. If I was advising you that there was a 60% chance of succeeding in the case and a 40% chance of losing, and I were to ask you, would you walk across the road if you thought there was a 40% chance of you being knocked down? You would look at it rather differently. I have said exactly the same thing in several different ways, but it has a different impact. So if a client then says to you, if he comes with an unsuccessful, ends up with an unsuccessful result, you never told me what my prospects were losing, at least you would have dealt with that, because you would have given both sides of that percentage. Now, the client obviously needs to understand the process that is involved, and therefore you analyse not just the law and the facts, but also the procedure that is going to be undertaken. It's a very different approach for both arbitration and litigation. Litigation is a terribly public event, and a terribly public event is not necessarily what every client wants. Arbitration may not be ideal because it may be that there are various limitations within the process. Again, within the analysis, you set out the different points for the client's benefit on the law, the merits, and the procedure. And of course, there needs to be the cost-benefit-risk analysis. You cannot assume anything. You cannot assume that your client has done it, has actually sat down with his business head on, especially if it is a highly personalized dispute where the client simply wants you to go in and get an immediate result, especially if the client has little or no experience with dispute resolution. And if he is aware, he or she is aware of the costs that are involved, a full schedule of costs all the way through to a final hearing, which he should have. The benefit, in other words, what's the likely outcome, what's he going to get at the end of this process, and the risk which you would have given to him as a result of your analysis. Now, we'll come on to the cost element of that in a bit, because the cost aspect is increasingly important. Both sides, as I will point out later, need to be aware of what the downside is, and if they don't know what the costs are likely to be from the outset, they're not going to know. Now, in court, certainly in England, parties are very well familiarized with what the costs are going to be from an early stage. They have to exchange cost schedules. As a matter of general practice, we think that that works very well and actually works well within arbitration as well, so that the parties can provide a schedule in advance and can actually be made the subject of cost budgeting, so they cannot frighten the other side away. If for the moment, if we assume, as we ought, that this is about access to justice, and if the credibility of both the litigation system and the arbitration system will be judged in accordance with how well it delivers on access to justice and the quality of justice, then frightening people off of the costs is going to be one sure way of making sure that neither are fit for purpose. So I make that point, I'll come back to it. My next point is this, about strategy. And I make a difference between strategy and tactics. Strategy probably defined. It is, someone once said that strategy is what happens above the shoulders, tactics is what happens below the shoulders. It is effectively the planning process versus the particular steps that are going to be taken in order to deliver on that plan. But as far as strategy is concerned, one needs to, first of all, identify the objectives of the client, whether they be commercial, reputational or personal. And in my experience, it is amazing how many clients do not actually know exactly what they want, or at least they don't know all that they want because they haven't been impressed as to what might be achieved. And I know this may be developed within the later session on mediation, but expanding the pie, building in all sorts of mediation type strategies. But I think at the outset of the litigation, you need to know what is your client's business and what do they want, and what can they potentially gain from the process. So that's the objective. And as far as the strategy which is realistic is concerned, that has to be informed by the analysis and also by the objectives and the resources. And likewise, because remember you're preparing both sides of the case, when it comes to strategy, you have to think about the strategy to be employed either on behalf of or in relation to the particular defendant. You'll be thinking about funding issues, not only for yourself but also for the defendant. Accounting issues, when will the accounts be published, what will this piece of litigation or arbitration do in respect of those accounts, when is the AGM, what are the shareholders going to say about this piece of litigation, what are the regulators going to say? I once did a very large case involving a casino, and when it came to the share purchase agreement and the fair consideration, and one of the issues in the case was one particular line of the accounts. Now, it had nothing to do with anything really in terms of my case, but it was an interesting point and it could potentially have some relevance. But the very fact that I had spotted, or we had spotted, that particular line in the accounts meant that it was devastating, because they knew that one of the questions later on would be, what are these theatre tickets that cost so much? And the fact that particular organization had an application of a very important application of a regulatory nature meant that case resolved itself on day three of the trial. The answer to that was never going to be given in open court. And reputational issues. Reputation is very important. Now, within arbitration, behind closed doors, in private, confidential, that may, to some extent, limit the exposure. In court, there can be huge collateral damage. So those are matters to take into account when it comes to strategy. You're identifying the pressure points on both sides. And as part of your planning, it is for you to set them all out in full, in both directions, how they affect both sides. Further, in terms of strategy, it wouldn't be much of a strategy, would it, if you didn't know who your team was or who was in your team. Let's just say this, the most important of your team is your client. We talk about the legal team, we talk about the expert team. Your client is the most important party in that team. Nobody will ever know more about that case than your client. And your client has got so much resource, it is incredible. Your client is available to think about it, to work on it, to provide great information, great insight. And that may seem like a statement of the obvious, but whenever I say, as counsel, as Queen's counsel to my client, I said, you are a member of this team, I'm going to give you some jobs to do. So I've given him a job, I've given him a job, I'm going to give you a job to do in this case. And that goes down extremely well, because they feel as though they are part of the process rather than being on the outside. That is fundamental. So not much point of having a strategy if you haven't clearly identified who the team is. Just one word to lawyers. I know no one in this room will ever do it, but don't dictate to clients. If you have a team and that client feels they're involved in a team, they don't need to dictate it to. You talk about it and you reason. And they can see the wants themselves if you talk it over in a measured way. Thankfully, the days of dictating from lawyers to clients are almost over. Now, the third area tactics. Now, this is when we find that everyone has got something to contribute in relation to this, because we've all come across that wonderful tactic that secured the great result. For example, the venue of proceedings. Which are you going to go for? If you've got an option, you may be stuck with arbitration, or you may not. You may want to revise the arbitration agreement, the seat. You may want to do all sorts of things.
agreement. In terms of litigation, there will be a question as to which court or the country you're actually in. Are you going to adopt the Italian torpedo approach, which is that wherever the proper place for litigation is, someone has not decided they want to issue proceedings in Italy. The expression Italian torpedo came from a phrase that was used in a case where they realized that if you had commenced your proceedings, first of all, in Italy, the chances of never seeing the light of day again in another jurisdiction were pretty slim because it took so long to actually get the matter dealt with in Italy at that time. And there are some other jurisdictions, Italy may be faster now, but we're still talking about the Italian torpedo. And certainly I'm involved in some huge litigation, especially involving property development in Cyprus and other jurisdictions, where there are significant questions about where is the appropriate place to be able to litigate those issues. And that is still very much under debate, but it can make a difference as to where these cases are determined. The timing of the proceedings. When are you going to issue your proceedings? Are you going to issue them just before the holiday time? The most inconvenient time? The time which is most sensitive as far as the other side are concerned, because it's a merger or an acquisition, or there's a major announcement that is about to be made? Those are all strategic decisions to be made by the person bringing the proceedings. The person bringing the proceedings can at least decide when to serve goes to arbitrate or when to commence the court. The scope and the number of proceedings is also going to be extremely important, because if you're going to issue proceedings at different stages, that may have a certain effect, whereas to issue a number of proceedings, personal claim, corporate claims, a derivative claim, third-party claims, or bring a counterclaim, those are all matters to be factored in. And again, having done the strategy analysis, you will consider what it is that is going to be most helpful to your case. Who are the parties? The parties who are going to be joined are going to be joined because they are relevant. That is always going to be the overarching consideration, but not every party who is potentially relevant is joined. It may be that you only need defendants A and B. C is a perfectly legitimate defendant, but actually C could be the one that is the one that will feel the most pressure as a result of being joined. Entirely legitimate if there is a call to action against them. The nature of the allegations that are made, again, that is something you would have to consider. Do you allege fraud? Do you allege bad faith? Do you allege conspiracy to use unlawful means? Or conspiracy to injure? Those are important matters because they have major reputational implications. And of course, you would only make the allegation in accordance with the relevant code of conduct. And in terms of interim orders, this is where jurisdictions differ enormously. Because in, for example, England, indeed the United Kingdom, we have freezing orders which are available on an interim basis, not just an enforcement of a judgment. Whereas in the United States, that would be regarded as anathema. It's very difficult to justify that in the United States, and certainly in Russia, one of the cases that was decided in the last few years, the first line from a single court in Russia, was that this is not an English court, as they threw out the suggestion that they would make a freezing order on an interim basis. Can I suggest this, that in terms of tactics, it is important to delineate the issues that exist between the parties and in the dispute. This is going to be very important. I think in terms of focusing your own analysis, it will be there for the analysis part, but it will also be there for tactics as the parties ensure that they're at least crossing swords on the relevant issues. Now, a good judge, a good arbitrator, would always insist that there is proper delineation of the list of issues. The list of issues may be extremely long and detailed. Certainly in the commercial court and the Chancery Division in England, as well as good arbitration practice, that will be done at the outset and exchanged and agreed, so it's an agreed list of issues. Who will be giving evidence? Again, you need to know your case, you need to know the individuals who are likely to be relevant. But what do you do if you've got a very poor witness, someone who is likely to cause some difficulty, or at least potentially be tripped up in cross-examination? So there's always that witness you're concerned about, and on that basis you would have to make a decision as to whether to put that witness forward or run the possibility of an adverse inference being drawn from the fact that he has not been produced when he could have been produced. And then finally, in relation to the tactics of it all, and I'm not going to say much about this, but it's alternative dispute resolution. I know that's going to be dealt with later in terms of mediation, but not just mediation, which can run alongside litigation and arbitration. I should just say that, and this will be explained later, mediation is a voluntary process and it's not binding. It's a facilitated form of negotiation, if you like. I was once asked, in fact this is a little bit 4 months ago, an experienced litigator in England asked me whether the mediation was binding. That of course a misunderstanding of what mediation is. And I was also asked on one occasion by an experienced litigator whether arbitration was just another form of mediation. We need to be very careful. These are very different regimes, they serve a very different purpose, but as well as mediation, you have expert determination, and something which I think is going to become more and more relevant, which is early neutral evaluation. Judges in England and Wales are very keen, in the commercial court and in the Chancery Division, that if you have a question where you want a judicial view, there is a facility available where you can ask a judge, who is not the judge who will deal with the trial, to express a view. Now, the advantage of that, in that scenario, is that's free, that you don't pay for that. And it's not binding, either. But at least you get the judicial input. And I wonder whether in the world of arbitration, for example, where there is a separate arbitration going on, if you had, for example, an experienced arbitrator who was not involved in that, whether a fresh pair of eyes might be available to express an early neutral evaluation of the issues. It can't be a heavy case, it cannot be hugely fact sensitive. But in terms of, say, a construction argument, interpretation of a contract, it might just be that that is the sort of kudos that can be brought there and unlock a potential issue. And even if it doesn't unlock it completely, so it can settle, it means that the parties are better informed as to what their risks are going forward. Now, I want to say something about costs. Any serious analysis and any serious arbitration and a piece of litigation in this day and age should involve total transparency in terms of costs from the outset. Parties who are fighting issue or case should know what the potential downside is. It should not come as a bolt out of the blue. Now, for those cases where money is no object, of course, there's no object. There is no difficulty with that. But for those who want to access justice and who want to be able to put their case and know that there is a certain downside, but not a downside that's going to totally ruin them, I think they're entitled to that. And I think if we don't abide by that, as the courts have led the way in England doing cost budgeting, then I think there is always a danger that the system, whether it's litigation or arbitration, is not going to be fit for purpose. The other advantage of cost budgeting is this. If you see cost budgets, which are vastly different, then it may well indicate that there is a totally different approach being taken by one side as opposed to the other. It may be that you can see that there is a misunderstanding as to what the issues actually are. If you have one side, for example, which is undertaking the expense of an electronic disclosure expert, and the other side is not, you know that there is a disparity in approach. approach, and you may want to address that. Likewise, if there is a major difference in the cost which is being incurred in terms of experts, it may be that there may be a misunderstanding as to what the questions are for the experts. Now, there can be disparities without any misunderstanding, of course there can, but it is another tool in the armory. And also, what we find is that the cost budgeting is much easier to settle cases. Because everyone at some point wants to know, if I settle, what will it cost? If it settles, what will I get in terms of my cost? What will I be left with? Well, if you haven't done the cost budgeting, you're going to have to do the work at that stage. You might as well do it at the outset. Finally, in terms of managing expectations, this is absolutely critical. The proceedings, whether they be litigation or arbitration, are long and involved and often fraught. Clients should understand what the potential downside is and what the difficult bits are going to be. When it comes to the final hearing, I was always taught when I started at the bar that the worst part of your case is when your own client finishes giving his evidence. That's important to know, because in the roller coaster of a final hearing, yes, your client will look to you after he's given evidence and say, well, how did I do? And if you have warned him that the worst part of the case is probably going to be when he finishes his evidence, we can look forward to the other side being cross-examined. At least he's got it in context. So that's important. Manage the expectations. The lawyer who thinks he's got a good case and tells his client that he thinks that actually you'll probably get summary judgment on this has served neither himself nor his own client, if that is the limit and the extent of his advice. If his advice is, it may be difficult to apply for summary judgment, difficult to obtain it, might be worth a go, we will keep it under review. That is much more realistic advice. And there is no thanks to anyone who over promises and under delivers. You are better to under promise and over deliver. Even better, it's sort of totally realistic. And finally, I'm just going to leave you with one quotation from Sun Tzu. So, from 2,500 years ago, he said this: strategy without tactics is the slowest route to victory. Tactics without strategy is the noise before defeat. I think I've made my point. So thank you very much. Now, we're going to hand over to Michael Stevens and to David Barnable and to Monia and Dickie Danes. I'm just going to say a few words of introduction, just very briefly. Michael Stevens is a barrister, arbitrator, mediator, and adjudicator, part-time judge in England and Wales, and also a media club president of the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators. David Barnable is the chairman of the Council of the Bar of Ireland. He's also chairman of the Irish Rule of Law International, and I know he's lectured all over the world. He's vice chairman of the Irish Sports Council, and the deputy disciplinary panel, and chairs the appeal board of the Irish Tax Institute. Also, as with Michael, a specialist commercial practitioner, and he has acted as an arbitrator as well as an advocate. And likewise, Monianni Dickie Danes, Queen's Counsel, is a silk at Two Temple Gardens in London, and also practices in Northern Ireland. Monianni is a specialist commercial practitioner, and also acts as an arbitrator. So I'm going to invite the three of you to come forward, and I'm going to hand over to Michael to moderate that session.
Mediate. We're going to hear first from my colleague Monia, about mediation and the lawyer's role, you'll find in the room a problem that we have drafted for you to consider. And that is the side one there. That will be distributed around, and you'll see that the problem involves a typical commercial contract involving the supply of goods and a project that is rapidly going wrong in the background. It's there just to give you a flavour of the sort of scenario where the circumstances that we're going to try and describe may well come into play. As you'll see on the back of that sheet, there are two questions that David and myself will attempt to address. One is going to tell us with the aid of the presentation about the lawyer's role within the mediation process. David and myself will try and give you a perspective from the point of view of the client through David's eyes and the lawyer through my eyes, addressing those questions. Then I'll give you just a moment then to have a look through the role, just to get a feel for what it's about. As you'll find from our discussion, in fact, the facts of the problem are unlikely to be captured, just to give you an idea of the sort of situation there, what we're talking about.
Certain outcomes of the litigation or arbitration, but that's what really creates the opportunity and the impetus to resolve things in another way before all that has been developed. And the process of negotiation is really assisted by an independent professional, that's what the mediator is. And that allows a party greater control over the outcome that they might have either the mediation or arbitration, litigation or arbitration. So, what I'm going to do is just give an introduction, and then I have divided the presentation up really into three stages. So that's pre-mediation, during the mediation, and after the mediation. I won't be surprised if I continue to have a role in relation to the mediation, even after it. So just by way of introduction, so often you hear what the mediator does, or you hear why mediation is a good thing for the client. This presentation is all about the lawyer's role. And the lawyer actually has a very, very important role in assisting the client during those three phases. Obviously, preparing, you heard from David, analysis, you could say preparation. If you prepare, you're likely to improve the chances of success for your client. It almost goes without saying, but it is worth saying, just to remember that. It's not something you just turn up to. It requires very careful preparation, like most things, to maximise your opportunity. Then you need to go to mediation thinking creatively. It's not arbitration, it's not litigation. Many, many things are possible. But they're much more likely to be possible if you thought through what the opportunities are. And you need stamina. I have never been to a mediation, I attend many of them, where at some stage, the client starts to flag. It's not going the way they thought it would. They're looking at the prospects of perhaps a settlement not resulting from it and feeling I'm invested in this process and now maybe I've got to sort of start thinking about arbitration or litigation. And really you come into your own at that stage. That's when your creative thinking comes into its own, when you start to try and think outside that box, other ways to cut through the blockage. Believe me, you have a really, really important important role at that time. So there's absolutely no point in you flagging. The client will be doing it, you shouldn't be. Then careful attention to the process and the outcome. Just think about where it's all going. Help remind your client what the objectives might be. Maybe those objectives change during the course of it, and you have to be a little bit alive to that possibility. And help your client see what the positives might be, even though it's not quite the way they thought it would be when they started. So then, this is the first stage in the way that I have divided this up. And that's what I call pre-mediation. And I've sort of worked around that anti-clockwise, as it were. So first of all, this is really Ed's point again. You have to try and help your client understand what the process is. It's a process, like anything else. And refine the sorts of things your client wants to achieve through it. And then you need to check your contract for whether it has any mediation provisions in it at all. And the jurisprudence of wherever you are. If you're the person initiating mediation and it's refused, are there certain options? If you're the person thinking of refusing it, are there repercussions for that? If you do that from a point of view of cost, if you then go on to litigate or arbitrate. And then timing is really important. When do you initiate the suggestion for mediation? And there are all sorts of costs and benefits about when you do it, and that's part of your strategy as well. And maybe even if you have started proceedings, it's not too late to think about mediation. If you've started it, then at what phase do you want to wait until you've had what we call discovery? Do you want to wait till the end of the pleadings? Do you want to wait till you've got the expert reports in? The further down you go down the process, the more costs you're incurring. But the better you may know about what the other side's case is. So there's a bit of a trade-off there. And even if you have got to the close of the case, whether it's arbitration or litigation, you can still mediate, because at that stage you don't know what the outcome is, and you may begin to see where it might go, and you're hedging your client's bet still. And even after you've got the award or judgment, depending what the case is, you can still mediate. And those of you who were at the talk yesterday may recall there was a discussion of adjudication. Well, adjudication, if you enforce it, it gives you a final decision. In terms of the enforcement, but the overall result is still not final. At that stage, you can begin to think, okay, maybe we won and we've got our enforced adjudicator's award. Well, maybe we should still mediate the entire dispute. That was just one part of it. So there's a lot to think about. Very important is who's going to be your mediator. What sort of qualifications do you want? Don't be afraid to check. Ask for the CV. Even if you know what their experience and expertise are, ask for their success rate. How many have they done like this? You're just about to consign your client's dispute into the hands of somebody. You really want to know that they're good at this. Then requirements. What's required if you're in arbitration or litigation? Do you want some directions from the court to help you along your way, to enable you to know that you've got the information that will give that mediator its best chance of success? And like David, your team, who do you want to attend? Obviously, you want somebody with decision-making abilities. You can't really have one without it. But in terms of... Sorry. It's mediation, about to start somewhere. Should we ask? In terms of the team, do you want an expert there? Do you want the financial director there? Who do you want? Who is going to actually help? I mean, there's all sorts of people you can have there, but who will actually help? And then in terms of documents, what do you want to share with the mediator, the other side? What do you want to have in the room but not share, hold back? So there's a lot to think about in this phase. And this is just an indication. There are many more things, and those of you who engage in mediation experience will probably write as many as that again on the book. But that's just an aid memoir to think about.
Thank you. So let's pause for a moment and look at our first two thoughts. First things first. David, as client, does it matter to you the approach that you take to this presentation process?
Thanks, Michael. We all know when we advise people in particular situations one of the first, things the client will be conscious of is, if you're in a dispute, a commercial dispute such as this, is do I want to be seen to be the person to make the first move? If I make the first move, will I be seen by the opposition as blinking first? Will that give some significant tactical advantage to the opposition? And in the problem that we have in front of us, there appears to be a contractual obligation to either negotiate or mediate before proceeding to any other stage of dispute resolution. So there is a choice to be made as to whether to negotiate or to seek to mediate. And as we all know, clients are extremely conscious of perception, and as I say, will not want to be seen to blink first. Now, it's certainly the case in Ireland, and I believe also in the United Kingdom, that as there has become a greater consciousness of mediation, as courts encourage mediation, and in fact, in the rules of court, it seriously encourage mediation. It's much easier as a lawyer, I think, and Michael, you can come back on this in a moment if you like it. It's much easier as a lawyer to say, well, look, if you suggest mediation to the other side, you're not actually seen as blinking first, because you are doing something that a court will expect you to do down the road. And so I think that's a really important decision to take at the very outset, to reassure the client, the client's point of view, the client's concern about either suggesting mediation or agreeing to go to mediation is not something that will be held against the client or will be seen as yielding up a significant tactical advantage to the other side. So the answer, I think, if you look at our first question, is perceptions do matter, but it is, from the client's point of view, certainly easier, I think, from a perception point of view, to say, well, look, there's a mediation clause in the agreement between us, so all I'm doing is doing what the agreement provides. I think that's quite different from a client's point of view. I think it's quite different from being seen to make the first step to negotiate or to seek, for example, a settlement meeting in the case.
As the lawyer, I would want to know whether my client needs to be assisted with negotiations. It may well be that face-to-face negotiations between the directors of the company can yet provide a resolution, but sometimes personalities and differences get so entrenched that trying to get parties to negotiate sensibly is impossible. That's the time when a third party, the mediator, can come in and be effective. So the idea of assisted negotiation under the banner of mediation is something that can always be recommended to the client. Confidentiality could be extremely important at this stage, and there might be a concern that in the informal situation of negotiations, that your opponent might perhaps let the cat out of the bag, which could have repercussions for your reputation within the industry. Perhaps the more formal setting of mediation is what's required to bring home the seriousness of the situation. If we move on to our second proposition, we can't agree on the mediator and we can't identify who we're supposed to be appointing. Does it matter at the end of the day? As the lawyer, I'd be saying to you, the client, what we need is someone we can trust to guide our negotiations, someone who may well have technical expertise and screws in this problem to help us. And I can find that individual perhaps through the directories, more likely through my personal knowledge of the market, and if not, through recommendations. Is that, as client, is that something that's going to satisfy you, that advice?
Michael, I think from a client's point of view, the client has come to you as a lawyer in the first place because the client trusts you and trusts your judgment. So I think if you are to advise me as the client, what steps should I take in relation to selection of a mediator? As a client, because that's generally outside my comfort zone, I would be placing considerable trust and reliance on the advice that you would give as a lawyer in that situation. I also think, from the point of view of a client, you make the point that one can identify a mediator from directories or otherwise. And as a client, I think you find that a client much more appreciates a recommendation based on personal knowledge, personal experience in other cases where you've dealt with the particular person as mediator, where you're able to say, well, yes, that he or she is an excellent mediator, has a nice style about them, and is somebody that we think you as a client will get on with. And often I think a client will ask you, as the lawyer, speaking from the client's point of view, will say, well, what do you think of this person? Do you think this person will work for this mediation? They may be extremely bright, extremely good at litigating, but are they a decent mediator? Are they a good mediator? Will they be able to deal with the difficult situations that we encounter in mediations?
Well, we managed to identify someone suitable to mediate for us, and we've got the mediation group. They will go from there.
Invite the parties to provide, in a plenary session like this, their opening statement. And very often the mediator likes the principals to do that. Before you get to that stage, you'll be in your room, and it's something you can actually think about. How conducive will it be to resolving this dispute if we actually have those opening statements? And the last three mediations I attended, we didn't have them. And the first time we didn't have them was because the dispute was so toxic that I was concerned that if the principals actually gave their opening statement, that would set the whole process of trying and resolving this back several hours. We would then spend an awful lot of time negotiating to get over what had been said in that opening meeting. Because once it's said, and it's said in front of people, it's actually very difficult to get over that. People have heard it. And I'll come to in a little while to the issue of face, which is also can be extremely important in mediation. So you need to think about that. And the last two I had after that initial experience, it seemed to me they went very well without it, to be perfectly honest. Because by the time we got to the mediation, everybody knew what the issue was. And we just needed to get on and with some help to resolving the dispute. And we didn't need people to take up positions that they may have to in order to resolve it, resile from it. So that's the first thing. Just think about it, whether it's actually helpful to have one. Just the fact that the mediator wants one doesn't mean that you have to have one. You could tell the mediator, I'm just not sure that would help in this mediation. Then, very often the mediator comes into the room and has a private session. You're going to be in that session with usually, and you need to think about what gets said in that session to make sure that your client has an opportunity to say exactly what the issues are, what the difficulties are, where they think they can move to try and resolve that. And that information the mediator takes to the other room. That's very, very important information. If the mediator doesn't have anything to work with, it's very difficult for him to help your client get to the stage of resolution. Then maintaining the momentum. Sometimes a client just gets bunkered in with something that I just must have this thing. And that's the thing that maybe is causing so much difficulty in resolving. And you need to help your client gain a bit of perspective around that. How important is that thing? Is that really a bottom line? Is that really a deal breaker if all the other things come into play? Is there anything else that could be offered or received that puts that of lesser importance and so on? And then breakout sessions. Now the mediator in control of the process is obviously going to suggest a lot of this themselves, and they don't really do necessarily to say that. But they very often are amenable to suggestions from you, and you can assist by that, and you can assist by saying maybe this is a time the principals really ought to meet. If they are at very high level, they may never have met before. They may not appreciate the dispute that's being created by the middle management. And when they're operating at that executive level, they're a little bit away from the cold face or the details, and maybe their meeting can actually be helpful, or maybe not. Maybe you want to suggest the experts meet and agree figures as figures, for example, case we get that far, at least we don't need to worry about that. Whatever it is, you can help by suggesting that. Maybe you should meet the mediator. Maybe there are things that your client can't tell the mediator for that issue of face, but they quite like the mediator to know. So you could get instructed to go and see the mediator, sit down and explain these things. That's information the mediator can work with, and the client hasn't had to say that. Sometimes that can be extremely important. The presentation of how the client feels these matters being dealt with. And that's something always to be alive to. And some mediations is more important than others. And then drafting, if you get as far as an agreement, what you want to put in it, even if you've got the heads of it, what other things can you put in that help your client, jurisdictional clause and so forth. Because once that agreement is reached, that's your contract. And that can be enforced. And how and where do you enforce it? And so on. And then looking forward, this is really important actually. If you can see that there is not going to be a resolution, what should you be doing now to get the best out of that process? And that can be extraordinarily important for the information you get at that stage. Not that you can use it openly, but you will at least know where the other side is on certain points. And that can be very important if you're going to carry on in a dispute by way of arbitration.
Now, with those thoughts in mind, we're going to take the next few questions together. As the lawyer, I would obviously want to advise my client that there ought to be representation in the mediation, if only to protect them from themselves, you might think. What I may be saying, though, is that you don't need perhaps more than one lawyer, that you can trust me as your immediate advisor to assist you in getting this mediation resolved. The benefit that a lawyer can bring to the mediation is twofold. First of all, ensuring that the process is effective and leads to an enforceable productive agreement. And secondly, acting as the facilitator to allow the client to take part in the process. One of the issues that we've raised for consideration is about arguments and advocacy. And you're here in the mediation room, different to the courtroom. Your lawyer is not going to stand up and grandstand in public for 20 minutes. Judge. Here our mediator is going to help us with our discussions to find a settlement. My role as your lawyer is to find a way to let you get out in front of your client and the mediator the concerns that are really trapping you so that we can make a fullest possible discussion to find a way forward. So it's not, I would say to you, a question of advocacy being used to win the argument to persuade the mediator. May want to get you and me to work together to persuade our opponents about the correctness and the force of our arguments. So when the mediator doesn't say anything to us, don't be alarmed about it. The mediator is not there to take positions. What we need to do, though, is be prepared when we go into the mediation room with the documents and the arguments that we look for. And I say to you as the client, what you've got to do is be frank. And you've got to be in a position to say, yes, we can do the deal. You've got to come armed with your authority to settle the case. So with those points in mind, does that give you any concerns as a client?
Well, of course it does, but I would need to be, as a client, educated, I think. This goes back to Monty's point at the very beginning, preparation of the client for the mediation. How is it different to the way things would be done if we were in arbitration or if we were litigating the issue in court? Can I just go back to one of the points that Maya made, is you can decide at the outset whether you're going to have an opening statement of both parties. And traditionally, if you do this by the book, you would have an opening statement by each side. But I agree with Maya. Quite often now, clients will ask, do we really need to have an opening statement from each side at the beginning of this mediation? Bearing in mind we've seen position papers from each side, we know what the correspondence says, we know what the issues are. I, as a client, don't particularly want to have to sit in a room and listen to my opponent's case being rammed down my throat. I would much rather if we could just get on with the business of trying to resolve the dispute. So there's been a move away, certainly, in Ireland, and certainly the way I've been doing mediations, to move away from having opening statements and to make sure that, unless they're absolutely necessary. Sometimes a client may say, well, look, I really want to know, I want to see who's in the other room. I want to see who is here from the opposing party. So I would like, if we all got in a room at the very beginning, and we introduced ourselves, and then we went back to our rooms. So that's something that the clients have said. As Michael says, very, very different process to an arbitration and litigation. And from a client's point of view, it can be quite frustrating that you may see your lawyer, if you choose to have representation, you may see your lawyer making what you believe are very telling points to the mediator. But the mediator doesn't really seem to be reacting at all. The mediator may be taking, he or she may be taking a few notes, maybe nodding sagely from time to time, but actually doesn't seem to be particularly convinced by the merits of the case. And from a client's point of view, again, unless the client is fully prepared as to what's coming down the tracks, that can be quite a frustrating exercise. And the client sometimes might think, well, you know, I'd like to give that mediator a bit of a shake so that he can really appreciate and accept the merits of what I'm saying. And the other thing from a client's point of view, when they get into the middle of a mediation, as Manya says, people flag. And I know in almost every single mediation that I've ever been involved in, there comes a point, normally in the middle of the afternoon, where the client will say, look, this is going nowhere. We've been sitting here in the room, apparently for the last hour, hour and a half, with nothing happening. And really, this is a complete waste of time, so we're out of here. So from a client's point of view, I think, if the client is prepared in advance, and if everybody says, you're going to feel like this at some point in the day, just get through it, get over it. If we manage to get over that hump, we may well resolve the dispute, and it'll be well worth having endured what you think might be these endless minutes or indeed hours sometimes of nothing apparently happening. So a client, I think, would be like to be reassured by the mediator and by the client's own legal team that this is quite normal. The fact that there is nothing apparently happening in one room doesn't mean that significant progress isn't being made in another room.
Well, having managed to prevent David walking out at 20 past four in the afternoon, it took until 5 to 12 that night to get everything sorted out when we all ran out of stamina. What do we do after the mediation?
It's a very early close from there. It quite often takes longer than that. Okay, post-mediation. So you finish the mediation, it hasn't either been successful or not. If it has been successful and you've got an agreement, and then you need to make sure that you're getting what your client wants out of that agreement. So check that your client is on track for whatever your client has to do, and you monitor the other party. Now, ideally, you would have checked the financial standing of the other party and been able to satisfy yourself as part of your due diligence that the other party can deliver what is within the range of outcomes and requires things. Going to want to receive, but stuff happens. In fact, most legal practitioners' careers are made on the basis that stuff happens. So it might have been all right when you started, but something's gone badly wrong, and you need to check that. Are there any protective orders that you need? Do you need to know something? Do you need to do something before whatever money there is flies out of the jurisdiction, or whatever it is? You just need to keep on top of that, because your client will not thank you for having gone through the whole exercise of mediation, only not to reap the benefits of it. So you need to keep on top of that. Then, if you haven't settled it, you need to understand why it didn't settle. That's a very, very important phase for you. And you need to analyse with the client why that dispute didn't settle at that time, understand what went wrong, where do you think both parties got to, why was that a bridge too far? What would have to change for you to be able to resolve it even now? That could be very possible. Maybe it came quite close, but it just wasn't possible at that time. Why? Maybe there was a missing bit of information that you needed. Well, can we keep it live still? And maybe sometimes that means keeping the mediator in the loop and saying, look, we're not actually that far apart. We couldn't do it that day, but we might do it if X and Y happened. And maybe you need the mediator to help you. Maybe you can do that yourselves by direct negotiations. You know what's required. And one that I came from just last week was exactly like that. We needed some extra figures. They just weren't available for mediation, but we know that if we get them, if we're within a certain range, we can do the deal. And and that's how it's been left. And we actually, at the end of the mediation, when we were not successful, we timetabled that. So we know where we are to try and achieve the final resolution. So those sorts of things that you can do. If you don't think you really at that stage can see any prospect, or maybe you're glad can't see any prospect of resolving it, even if no more information comes through, then here is another very important phase. Well, you now probably know more about the other side's case than you did before you started. More to the point, your client probably knows more about his case than before you started, because it's been stress tested. That's what was going on, in order to try and see where the weaknesses were and trying to see what the risk management might look like. So use that information to enable you to prepare for what might be the inevitable, either the continuation of litigation arbitration or the launching of those proceedings. That's really important information. Your clients pay for it, so use it.
It's at 5 to 12 when you think you've done the deal, but the lawyer is perhaps his or her most vulnerable. The problem is that all too often in mediations, we can go on and on all day, and eventually one party will give in, if only through tiredness. And we're all tired, and this is where mistakes happen. Particularly in situations where there's more than one person involved in the decision making. So one of the key points I suggest for the lawyer at the end of the mediation is to ensure that whatever agreement is reached at that stage is accurately recorded, even if it's just the heads of the agreement rather than the individual clause, that it does reflect what the parties have agreed, and that it is approved by your client. The danger is that the midnight clause is the one that's actually ineffective, that actually doesn't settle the deal as you thought it did, and just creates a whole new round of satellite litigation. This can be particularly the case where your client may have to refer back to another individual, another department, to ensure that the final deal
is at the very beginning. And I would want to be reassured that when it comes to midnight or one or two in the morning, that a settlement reached at that point will stand up. And I might be concerned at times just to get out of that room, that the client isn't in a situation where he or she will simply agree to anything in order to get out of the mediation. And so I think that's something I would really want to make sure that my lawyers were on top of, were advising me about. And also that if, for example, we don't reach a deal but we're close, I want to be advised, well, look, what does that mean? Does it mean that I can now go ahead and commence my proceedings? Would that be the wise or advisable thing to do? Or should we hang in with the process, as Manya says, try and keep the mediator in the loop and adjourn the mediation to allow discussions to continue? And I, as the client, may take the view at that point, look, I put enough into this, it hasn't settled, and to hell with the whole process. I want to litigate the issue now, and I'd like, I'm sure, to be advised on whether that's a good or a bad thing, or a wise or an unwise thing to do. And I think I would also want to be advised on the wisdom of adjourning the mediation at all, if that's a good idea or a bad idea. But equally, it may be that I'm a client that does, but even if the dispute doesn't settle, that I get something out of the mediation and that I've had an opportunity not just to get things off my chest, but to impress on the other side the merits of my case in as best a way I can, so that even if we don't settle, that the opposition is more aware after the mediation of the weakness of the opposition's case and the strength of my case. And I might just think that that's a good thing to have got out of the mediation, even if it doesn't settle all this dispute.
Thank you very much. Monia, you're an experienced mediator. Today we talk about the lawyer's role. Have you got any comments about how the mediator can make it an effective process?
Well, completely contrary to what I just was saying. The mediator needs to make sure that they're not just hearing from the lawyers. The lawyers are there to assist, and sometimes they don't always assist. Sometimes they get in the way. And part of the reason why we sometimes get in the way is because it may be partly to do with their advice that we are where we are. And so they may not be part of the solution. Or maybe part of the, maybe it's the experts who are there, and it's part of their advice, which is why we are where we are. And so the mediator, I think, needs to make sure that at some point they speak directly to the client, and they understand what the client's interest is, and where the client's bottom line is. And that might not always be the same place, doing the best we can as lawyers, as where the lawyer has presented. And I have seen it many, many times. I can't emphasize the importance of your those lawyers to make sure that your client gets to articulate its concerns. That's what you need to resolve. At the end of the day, it's two clients who have to resolve their dispute, not two sets of lawyers.
And I think I conclude by saying to you on behalf of all of us that at the end of the day, if you do successfully resolve your mediation, a few greater feelings of satisfaction that you can enjoy in the world and having done the job that way. Thank you very much for your attention. We're now going to have a break for a short period of time, and then we'll resume with a further presentation from our colleagues Andrew Sicker, Professor Massacre, and Teresa Cosuera.
Just before we have that break, can I just take this opportunity now to invite you to the fifth annual BICFA meeting in Belfast. You should all have a flyer in front of you. If you turn to the reverse page of it, you'll see what the topics are. So every year BICFA goes to one of our jurisdictions. This year we were in Dublin. Next year we're going to be in Belfast. And I think I'm the only representative from Belfast, so I'm inviting all of you personally. And you will see that we're really dealing with technology. That's the theme of it. Both as to a way of conducting cases, as a way of generating rights, and a way of trying to use it in terms of how cases progress, whether in court or on an arbitration. So please think about it. If you have an opportunity to come, you are very, very welcome. We'll show you an Irish law.
If I might just say, I have to leave at this point, so no offense to anyone, it's not a lack of interest, it's a little bit much.
Thank you very much
for coming.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much.
You can come out with us from the UK, or come slightly closer, but still giving a few time to be here. But I'm extremely grateful, of course, to Professor and to the university for the arrangements of the hotel. There are three of us going to be talking about arbitrating construction disputes. And the professor is, as professors are wont to do, going to do about scrapping before the club bit. And that's way beyond me, and I don't do any service by saying it's maybe beyond me as well. So we're going to do the rough and tumble stuff. And we're going to look at really experts. Experts, we've heard about clients, we've heard about strategies of lawyers, we've heard about lawyers and clients interacting in the mediation. And some of the most important people in any dispute, construction disputes in particular, tend to be fairly heavily expert based. So we look at that. But first of all, pass over to the professor.
That is the mine. Hello, everyone. I think that is what. All right. I think I'll see what I'm standing. I think it's actually the warning part. So you don't have to be here. And these guys are doing the interesting ones, more frightening ones. So, first of all, do we have people, experts, who are experts in UAE arbitration? None. Great. That's the thing about it. Then I'm relaxed now. So, when David asked me to speak on arbitration or construction arbitration, I was wondering what I should say. It's a very big topic. We spend almost
dedicate 60 to 40 hours speaking to our students about the general principles of construction arbitration. And I thought that it might be interesting for you all to know about the court's role and the beauty of the court when it comes, the beauty of the court when it comes to arbitration here in the UAE. So I took that part, and I said that I will speak about the role of the court, the UAE court, in pre-arbitration proceedings and during the hearings. And then I will leave the post-arbitration because I think somebody will talk about the enforcement and challenge. So arbitration was, till now we don't have really a separate code of arbitration here. So arbitration law is part of the UAE federal law, civil procedures, and we refer to it as LCP. Arbitration is covered by articles 203, 213, as you see, we don't have about 15 articles. So we don't have comprehensive regulation of arbitration here in UAE. What we rely on, in addition to these rules, the rules of arbitration that can be found in some institutions. So we have, for example, the Dubai International Arbitration Center rules, and we have the DIFC and CIA arbitration rules here as well. So we rely on the rules if we elect to have institutional arbitration. We have also ad hoc arbitration, where of course the tribunal can decide on the procedure in the Dubai International Arbitration Center has a separate arbitration law that applies where the seat law is the DIFC. That law is a separate law, and actually it is more comprehensive, much more comprehensive than the federal law when it comes to arbitration. We have a draft arbitration law. It's been a draft for a while, a few years, still working on it. Slow but surely effective is the British way, yeah? So we are doing anything, but it's too small. So hopefully, soon we'll have a federal arbitration law. The independence of arbitration is somehow guaranteed as any arbitration around the world. So we have the security or autonomy principle. One thing about it, there is nothing in the law speaking about the superiority doctrine. It is the practice of the court. We have decisions of the Cassation Court of Dubai. For your knowledge, we have four Supreme Courts in UAE. We have the Federal Supreme Court, Abu Dhabi Cassation Court, Dubai Cassation Court, and the Ras Al Khaimah Cassation Court. Because each emirate here is allowed to have its own judicial system. So the three emirates elected to have their own judicial system. These are Abu Dhabi, Dubai, Ras Al Khaimah, and the others, belong in the federal system. So yes, autonomy principle applies here, but as a matter of practice, it's a decision of the Cassation Court rather than the law. The competence principle also applies. Determination of the procedures under the ad hoc arbitration is also allowed. So the tribunal can determine on the procedures. No judicial control of errors of law. And this is what I had a chat with Mike and I asked him at the beginning. You still have this in him? He said, yes, you can challenge the award in the basis of error in law. So, no, this stuff doesn't happen here. So we have specific grounds of challenge of the award. The arbitration award is considered fine. Grounds of challenge are limited and mostly procedural. So the role of the court can start before the tribunal is formed. So three possible areas of court intervention, I should say two, I think I deleted one, just some practice. So enforcing the arbitration agreement, this is one of the roles of the court, and the second one, establishing the tribunal, the arbitral tribunal in second cases. So for the enforcement of arbitration agreement, a case may be filed in the court despite the existence of arbitration clause or sufficient. So one of the parties decided just to ignore the arbitration clause, thinking that the dispute is not covered by this arbitration clause. So files the case in court, the other party will have the right to object. So the defendant will have the choice whether to go on with the case or to object. Now the objection must be in the first hearing. If he appears before the court and does not object, he will lose that right. And the court will continue looking into that case despite the existence of the arbitration clause. So that's, it's different from the central model law. The central model law says there's a statement. So it's not fair hearing. The second role of the court, that's pre-arbitration proceedings, is the establishment of the arbitral tribunal, forming the arbitral tribunal. If parties can form the tribunal, that's fine. Otherwise, one of the parties may file or put a request to the court to form the tribunal. This happens where parties fail to appoint the respondents arbitrator or to the sole arbitrator. Second situation where parties challenge the impartiality of the arbitrators. This is called disqualification of arbitrators under Article 207. They're allowed to do that. So basically, in these two cases situations, the court may intervene to form the tribunal. During the arbitral hearings, the court has the usual role, which is mostly about the intermediaries. In UAE, we don't have any provisional law that authorizes the tribunal to issue intermediaries. And even if it does, it will not have the power to enforce the rules. So we have that point. So we understand that the court's role should be limited when the case is in the hands of arbitrators. That's the will of the parties. They chose to hire a judge as the arbitrator. However, intermediaries need to be enforced by the court. Intermediaries, I don't think that we can explain too much about this, but just temporary jobs that we need to do in the proceedings. Reasoning account, reasoning account is one of these. Preventing somebody from leaving the country. Another one, asking a third party to deliver documents, to show evidence, witnesses, force a witness to appear before tribunal. So, Article 22 of the Civil Procedures Law makes intermediaries within the discretion of the court. So it is for the court to decide the intermediaries, so we need to put a request for the court. The court's role in intermediaries is significant. First, intermediaries may be required to before the formation of the tribunal. Formation of the tribunal will take time, and sometimes we need to visa an account or to get some evidence that we may lose it later. The powers of an arbitral tribunal are generally limited to the parties involved. Also, intermediaries cannot be enforced under the condition of the recognition and enforcement of foreign arbitral award in the US Convention. So, we still need the involvement of the court in this case. I'm not sure about this point, but I think it is. In Scotland, the tribunal may issue an award to make an intermediary. So it's like original award. Under the Act rules here, the Dubai International Financial Center, I found that Article 371 is that tribunal may make preliminary intermediary. That would be partial or final. So basically, the rules of arbitration for some institutes here adopt that way, just provide to deliver provisional or interim measure by labeling it an award. Although the rule is there, but when we look at the arbitration law in the country, we find that the enforcement is of the final award. That's the enforcement. And the challenge is of the final award in arbitration. But we have this rule in India, and I'm not sure how often it was used. There are many types of interim measures, maintain a strong business goal, provide the means of preserving assets, take action that would prevent or refrain from taking action that's likely to cause current or imminent harm, preserve evidence. The UN Central Law provides us with some factors that we need to consider, and these factors are really applicable here. The court use similar factors to consider whether what we need to issue an interim measure. And now we need the post-arbitration for the enforcement and judicial challenge of our power. So that's it about the interim measures and about the role or the intervention of the UN court in arbitration. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, now for after the clever and not the tall board bit, to the rough and tumble. Experts. As I indicated in my opening remarks, I think construction disputes, arbitration and litigation are uniquely expert-heavy and expert-led. Monia talked about the fact that sometimes the reason why a party is in a dispute in the first place is because an expert who's often brought on board by the client directly, perhaps, takes a particular position and drives a matter forward. The approach to the management of experts has changed dramatically over the last 15 to 20 years. Those of us who are long tooth enough to remember will recall sitting in meetings with experts where an expert would literally take out a pen and an empty piece of paper and say, "What would you like me to say, Mr. Barrister, this little client?" Can't do that, apparently. But what can you do? And that's one thing hopefully discuss now. What can you do when you have an expert who does come with a report that he or she has written themselves, but frankly does not address any of the issues in the case? Doesn't appear to have been written by anyone with expertise, despite the fact that this person clearly does have expertise. So what can you do? So, reason.
Thanks, Andrew. I guess just taking it back a step, challenge or recalcitrant debtors, people against whom avoidance arbitrage is always in debate. This is the most popular of provisions which are relied upon, because what they try and do is to sneak in challenges on the merits of an award, which is not allowed under UAE law. But what they try and do is use this invalidity ground to try and challenge the merits of an award, or to rely upon what they regard as procedural defects to validate an award, but one of them are specifically referred to in the legislation. So that's what I'm going to talk about. And what I thought I'd do is talk about a case, and actually it's an English case. It's a TCC case. However, those of you who are familiar with Dubai and its environment will notice some familiar names in that case. And perhaps the most familiar is Maydan Group. Now, Maydan are responsible for a number of iconic building projects, and indeed, Current Canal, I believe, is part of their stable. But in 2008, 2009, they decided to build a race course. And they contracted with a main contractor, and they also sought to appoint a nominated subcontractor called Honeywell. Now, I won't bore you with the background and the details of all of this. Suffice it to say that the global financial crisis came at a rather inconvenient and unfortunate juncture in the letting of this contract. And what ultimately happened was that the nominated subcontractor who was responsible for the extra low voltage system to be installed at the race course, Honeywell, were ultimately contracted directly by MEDAT to provide their services. There was a number of payment issues. Again, very common. When I first arrived, it was pretty much the only basis of disputes, i.e. Non-payment for design and other related issues. And in consequence, Honeywell decided to start an arbitration against MEDAT for unpaid sums. That was in 2010. So that's a DIAC arbitration which they started. The reason why I'm talking to you guys about it is because the arbitration went ahead, there was a decision, there was an award, there was all sorts of procedural shenanigans, and ultimately Honeywell tried to enforce their award in the UK. And so they went to TCC and Mr. Justice Ramsay for leave to enforce. And as a consequence of that, we were given a prime seat in the theatre that was the arbitration proceedings between MEDAT and Honeywell. And I've described it there as the case that has everything, because it is a prime illustration of exactly the kind of procedural issues that you will see in any arbitration where one party is somewhat reluctant to come to the party and is seeking to set up a position where it can make procedural challenges further on down the line. And so what we have is a reported English case which goes through the arbitration process and proceedings here at Dubai and sets out some of the arguments that were raised during the course of the process and also subsequently designed to validate the award. And we had pretty much everything in that case. So the proceedings were commenced in 2010. MEDAT refused to acknowledge them. There was an argument about whether the correct party had been included in the request for arbitration. I believe it was served against MEDAT Group LLC. They said it was actually MEDAT LLC who were the correct party, so they refused to acknowledge the arbitration started. They claimed that the arbitration agreement was invalid. It had been procured by bribery. They refused to take part in the proceedings, so they refused to agree to the appointment of an arbitrator or to nominate their own arbitrator. They then sought to challenge the arbitrator who was appointed by DIAC in the absence of their agreement to appoint. The proceedings went ahead without them participating, and an award was eventually rendered. They sought to start parallel arbitration proceedings on exactly the same issues in DIAC. They sought the assistance of the local courts to stop the first set of proceedings going ahead. And essentially, what they did was they raised all these grounds and all these issues before Mr. Justice Ramsay as reasons for him to refuse to give leave to Honeywell to enforce their award in the UK. So we had an exposition of all these issues, and we had also Mr. Justice Ramsay's decision in relation to them. And I've just given you a brief highlights of his decision, and basically he dismissed all the claims, objections, essentially on the basis that if they wanted to make those objections, then they should have done in the arbitration. There's no reason for them to wait until the enforcement stage. He was also extremely scathing about the merits of some of the arguments. And the bottom line was that what he was saying to MEDAT as well, if you refuse to participate in the arbitration, then you do so at your own risk. So that was all well and good, and that was very interesting to get an English judge's views on the merits of some of the claims and arguments that have been raised. However, an English judge is a very different animal from a UAE judge, and therefore what we need to look at is how we think that the UAE courts are likely to react to similar issues, because as I've said, the case of Honeywell is very illustrative of the arguments that we see. And I think my starting point is to say that firstly, if you ask me a question, will my arbitration award be enforced by the UAE courts as a general principle, then the answer is, well, probably yes, because it is the policy of the government and it is the policy of the UAE courts to support and to enforce valid arbitration agreements and validly conducted arbitrations. That is their policy, and I think there were some interesting comments about some of the support that the local courts might provide in that regard. And I have some questions of my own in relation to that. I don't think I've got enough time to start quizzing the other panelists. I'll do that afterwards. But so the general principle is that there is support, but unfortunately, our experience is that the UAE courts are not particularly ruthless, if I think that's the right word, in making sure that parties do not raise what might be regarded as frivolous or unmeritorious grounds for resisting enforcement. And indeed, we've seen judgments and decisions where enforcement has not been allowed for some of the reasons which I mentioned earlier. Now, I've given two examples of recent cases where enforcement was refused because of a procedural irregularity. In that case, there was a majority tribunal decision. It was all done in the appropriate form. There was an award issue, but what they failed to do was to make specific reference to the dissenting opinion, which was required, it is said by the court, to be included within the award itself. So to actually reference the dissenting judgment. A second recent case is that, and I suspect it's one that Sam's going to talk about, is enforcement was refused on the grounds of public policy. That was on the basis that there was three arbitral awards and they dealt with real estate issues, and it was argued that real estate property issues was matters which under UAE law should only be dealt with by the courts. This isn't simply something which is theoretical risk; it is an actual risk. And what I thought I'd do is just give you some examples of cases where I've been involved with where certain grounds of challenge have been raised. So, for example, the award was not signed in the UAE. Now, there's various provisions related to that in the code. And the short answer to that, how do you avoid that? Well, you make sure it is signed in the UAE. Now, that sounds very easy because you usually, generally the proceedings will be in the UAE. Can cause some problems. I was very unpopular indeed with a tribunal which had issued an award in my client's favour for a considerable amount of money. There was some typographical errors in the award, which the other side said needed to be corrected. And there was a calculation error which changed the award from 220 million to 219,998,999 fees, whatever, which needed to be corrected. So they said, okay, that's fine, we'll just do a supplemental award and we'll post it to you. And I said, I'm afraid not, you're going to have to come to, these guys are based in Australia, they were based in the UK, they were based in Europe, I'm afraid you're going to have to come here and you're going to have to sign it. And so the tribunal said, well, that's just literally, we'll just have to fly in and sign it and go home again. And what about the costs? And obviously I didn't want to incur that cost. But I know that's one of the things that can be a problem is if you haven't got evidence to show that it was signed in the UAE by all the tribunal members. So I had to get them to come and to sign it in. So they had a holiday to the UAE if it was only for a day. Improper extension of time. Now, of course, most of you will know that the default position for UAE arbitral awards is that they must be rendered within 6 months. The parties can agree and DIAC and AFCAC allow for extensions at that time. You've got to make sure that it's done properly though. And you also possibly want to make sure the parties agree to it. I've seen awards challenged on the basis that there was some irregularity in the extension of time granted in relation to the rendering of the award. challenges for the arbitrators failing to sign all the pages. So all the arbitrators, three-man tribunal, sign all the pages of the award, including the appendices. That is quite an undertaking. I've had awards which have been over 1,000 pages, and I can tell you your wrist is pretty sore at the end of all of that. And sometimes you might miss a page, so make sure you check them. Make, if there is a page that's been missed, then send it back and ask them to resign it. Procedural unfairness. Now, this is an interesting one. I did a case a few years ago, and we were in a room similar to this. It was slightly smaller, and you can see where the air conditioning vents are. And here, it's about even, so you can see that this side is just about the same position as this side. But, as is common in a lot of hotels and meeting rooms in Dubai, the air conditioning tends to favour one side of the room or another. So they'll use the fans from one side to chill that part of the room, and then the air will move over to the other side of the room, and eventually the whole room will be nice and comfortable. So I was in this arbitration, and it was in a hotel down on the Shadeside Road, and we had control of the air conditioning, and because it was on our side of the room. And our counsel was a bit of a fresh air, like cold air freak, so he kept on going over and just adjusting the air conditioning so that it was quite low. And the other side eventually said to the tribunal, "We are freezing here. Please will you tell counsel for the other side to stop adjusting the air conditioning?" And we all had a good laugh about that, and it was all forgotten about, until the challenge to enforcement came along. And one of the grounds was that we had allegedly been torturing the other side because of the way we've been adjusting the air conditioning. Now, fortunately, that was a ground that wasn't, the court decided that that wasn't sufficient reason to annul the award. But it does go to show how careful that you need to be. Now, so what lessons have we learned from all of this? Make sure you don't play around with the air conditioning. But no, seriously, there's no doctrine of binding precedent in the UAE, so that makes it very difficult to advise clients about what will be acceptable and what will not be acceptable to the courts in relation to enforcement issues. However, if you're sensible about the way in which you conduct your arbitration, you make sure that to the extent it is possible, that there is strict compliance, not compliance in theory, but in practice, with what might be regarded as simply procedural or administrative issues, such as the signing of the award, such as the place in which it's physically delivered, then you are half the way along the road to making sure that you don't have any problems on enforcement. You need to be robust in the way that you deal with things, but also, and this is kind of in my practical experience, you need to help the tribunal. If you're a practitioner and you know that the other side are at best reluctant participants and at worst are looking for any reason whatsoever to defeat a legitimate claim, and therefore are planning their strategy accordingly, so they're setting little traps and little pitfalls to fall into during the procedure so that they can put their hands up at the end of it all and say procedural irregularity. You've just got to be really aware of it and make sure that you are, it's difficult to say to the tribunal, "Oh, he's not playing fair, don't listen to what he says." You've got to do it in a subtle way. Lawyer being subtle, that's a bit new, but you've got to do it in a way that is reasonable, but making sure that the tribunal is aware of possible pitfalls, and that's particularly the case where you've got a tribunal who maybe not familiar with the UAE courts and its practices. So I think I've used up my 15 minutes. I haven't really touched the surface particularly, so if anyone's got any questions, then please feel free to come and have a chat to me afterwards. I would also be really interested to hear of any other war stories. I'm sure there are others. So I'm sure Reeves may have some and some of the other speakers. So please let me know. But anyway, I'll pass on to Sam now, and
and he will take on for the next part.
Lovely. Thank you very much, Mark. That was extremely informative. I'll make sure I'm wary about the air conditioning here on the next occasion. I think what's worse is the professor's face when he was inside relief when he knew that the award wasn't set aside.
Yes.
There was a look on your face and you're just going to say, oh my God, look.
You're right.
Okay, well, I'm on the final part, and I'm really conscious that there is a worldwide phenomenon known as Dubai traffic, so I'm going to be as quick as possible given the time. The proposition that I'm putting forward, and the question I'm asking really today, just missed out there, is there a trend emerging for the enforcement of arbitral awards, foreign arbitral awards, in the UAE? And it's really benefited from quite a few recent cases, both in the Court of Appeal in Dubai, that demonstrated a real positive trend to the enforcement of arbitral awards. But I'm going to start I'm going to go back a bit further than that, about 5 to 10 years, to demonstrate this growing trend. And I say that on the basis of this, and I apologise at the outset, but I'm going to have to consider some cases, and I know this is a civil law jurisdiction, but it's a good way of demonstrating where the political world's going. The first case that I've looked at there, in terms of demonstrating this positive kind of attitude, is the 2005 case at the UAE Court of Cessation, which essentially said that the court held that the enforcing court is precluded, as Mark was saying, from examining the merits of the award. And that followed on recently, in the year after, 2006, where the court said this in terms that when the court ratifies an arbitration award, and I quote, it may not deal with it from the point of view of the merits or to the extent to which it complies with the law. So it's pretty clear, in my view, the way things are going. That view was echoed in the Union Supreme Court in its language in 2008, when it said pretty much exactly the same thing, that you know, you can't look at the merits, it's got to be via the law convention. And I should pause there to say that this is a trend moving away from the low watermark, as I would say, of the Betrel type case in Dubai, where there was a refusal to enforce an award because the manner in which evidence was obtained in the arbitration wasn't pursued to UAE law type, which that was the low watermark. But I'll press the pause button again to move on to the 2010 case of the that's on there. Which was the Court of First Instance, which ratified two arbitral awards made by sole arbitrators in London in relation to the London Maritime Arbitrators Association. And I think this was the first, I have it on good authority, this was the first time a foreign award was actually ratified in the UAE in accordance with the New York Convention. And then we come to the 2011 case of Maxwell and Airman, which rejected an appeal against the decision of the Dubai Court of First Instance to issue an execution order to enforce two LCIA arbitration awards with an English seat. So again, another good example. And there's also two related examples of foreign arbitral awards being ratified at first instance in 2011 and by the Court of Appeal again in February, I think to be precise, 2nd February 2012. This list goes on, and I'm not going to take you through all the cases because of time, but it'd be useful to kind of jump slightly to the last case on the list, which is the Hong Kong shipping case, which I haven't been able to find specific details of because of the nature of this jurisdiction. But I've been able to get this information, which all sounds really positive. Perhaps Mark may be able to assist me in terms of case names and perhaps who was involved, maybe Mark was. Essentially, this last case was a Hong Kong shipping-based case where the claimant commenced arbitral proceedings in London, and three awards were awarded between the space of 2011 and 2013. Now, and all in favour of the claimant. Proceedings were then issued in the Dubai Court of First Instance to recognise and enforce, I think, one or even three of the awards, and it concluded that all were valid arbitration agreements because at the end of it, what happened was that it was suggested that there was an email exchange between the parties which suggested that the charter party, this is the shipping case, had to be dated and signed, and in transpired that one of the documents hadn't been signed, albeit it had been dated. So the Court of Appeal, the first instance, said can't enforce it for all the reasons that we've seen before, and the Court of Appeal, the Dubai Court of Appeal, overturned the decision of the Court of First Instance and ordered the recognition and enforcement of the London award, and recognised in turn, and this is quite significant, that the New York Convention and English law recognised that an arbitration and its agreement can be formed by way of email correspondence. So that's what was really important. But it's equally important, and it's under appeal. So we don't know where it's better.